prepared to take the constitutional oath?
I am.
Place your left hand on the Bible and raise your right hand and repeat after me. I, Ronald Reagan, do solemnly swear.
I, Ronald Reagan, do solemnly swear.
That I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States.
That I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States.
Morning, Jim.
And will, to the best of my ability, preserve, protect, and defend.
And will, to the best of my ability, preserve, protect, and defend
the Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the United States.
So help you God.
So help me God.
Now, I congratulate you, sir.
Yes, it was quite a day. A new beginning.
You know, you don't really become president. The presidency is an institution. And you have temporary custody of it.
I know that the image is that it's a very lonely job and you're out there all on your own for everything that has to be decided or done. That's not quite true. I've always believed that the other people around you here are meant to be here and to contribute. And you know that the best counsel and the opinions, and many times varied opinions, opposition as well as approval of whatever's being discussed, that you're hearing these honest views from these very capable men and women who have given up so much, so many of them in their private lives, to come here and serve. You don't feel alone. I believe that the Vice President, George Bush, is more involved in policy matters of this administration, government in general, here in the executive branch, than any vice president we've probably ever had.
It's just different. The mood is different. It's not that everybody agrees with what you're doing, but there's a certain respect for the United States of America, and it is loud and it's clear, and I run into that all over the country. People say, you know, we're pleased the president's taken these strong positions, and they might argue with you on one or two things if you gave them a chance, but they're back. You get the feeling that the country's moving again, a certain pride level.
The bottom line with President Reagan is that he has brought back respect for the White House. Period. That's it.
There's a whole new attitude in America today, and I think that needs to be continued.
It used to be the Americans took it for granted they were American. Now it seems like they're really proud.
I feel more patriotic towards my country, and I feel more proud to be an American.
He put me to work. He's going to keep me there. The man did a good job, and I hope he's going to go for another 40 years. God bless America.
I even hear songs on the radio, TV now, says I'm proud to be an American.
If tomorrow all the things were gone, I'd work for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free, and I won't forget the men today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA.
Yes, there's been a lot of talk about a reawakened patriotism in our country and in our military. There's now a renewed sense of pride and patriotism there too. We recently were on a trip to Asia. On Sunday in South Korea, I went up to the demilitarized zone. Went to the outdoor church service with our troops there.
May we
we bow our heads together for the invocation?
I met with a great many of the men. I had a chance to talk with them individually. I was so proud to hear not grumbling or I want to go home, but to hear the pride with which they carry out their duties there.
It looks good.
And I have never seen such morale, such esprit de corps, such pride in their work. All of us here at home should remember all those young men and women on the frontiers of freedom.
PV2 Michaels from Elkton Mound.
I hope that people out there recognize what a wonderful bunch of young people we've got in the military now. When they see someone in the street in uniform, I hope they'll go up and say hello and maybe tell them they're a little proud. Well, proud to know you.
Proud to know you too, sir.
The president's policies, I'm 100% behind because he's strong and his strong defense.
I think President Reagan is getting us back to basics, back to things that keep our nation surviving and strong, like a good defense and a good economy.
The economy has never been as great as it has been now in 20 years. Unemployment is down, interest rates are down, more people are buying homes than ever before.
I really feel that we're going to be better off in the long run.
We're on the upward swing, and the factories are working much stronger than before. The people are getting back to work.
People are traveling more, business is better, people are on business trips, people are on vacations. They're spending more money.
We're back on top.
You know, it's hard to believe that it was less than 4 short years ago that interest rates were going through the roof. Inflation was, of course, the single biggest culprit and was responsible for those high interest rates. But you can understand why tackling inflation head on was one of our first priorities. And we went at it tooth and nail and brought it down. And we've kept it down. That wasn't wishful thinking, and it did become reality. Since January of 81, the prime rate has been pared by 40%. Mortgage interest rates have come down 4 percentage points since their peak. Now that makes home ownership possible for 17 million American households that couldn't afford it just 2.5 years ago. And the same goes for automobiles too. Lower loan rates have made cars a lot more affordable for a lot more people. Still, it is good to see people buying homes and cars again, to see America's automobile industry regaining its strength and taking a backseat to no one. So, we're going to keep on with what we're doing. We're going to bring those interest rates down further by keeping inflation down once and for all.
I think he's just doggone honest. It's remarkable. He's been on television, what have I heard, 26 times, talking to us about what he's doing. Now he's not doing that for any other reason than to make it real clear. And if anybody has any question about where he's headed, it's their fault. Maybe they don't have a television.
I've made a commitment, not just as president, but as a senior citizen myself, that we must have a Social Security system that keeps its promise to the people who kept their promise to America.
The president has done a lot of things, but bringing inflation down, I think, is probably the best thing he's done for older people, for everybody.
I feel strongly about keeping inflation down, interest rates down, but also making sure that no one pulls the rug out from under those people who are dependent on Social Security.
I know that President Reagan is a caring man, that he cares about old people and children and ill people.
There is no threat from anyone, certainly not from this administration, to Social Security.
President Reagan!
I didn't know I was shot. In fact, I was still asking, what was that noise? I thought it was firecrackers. And the next thing I knew, Jerry, Secret Service, had simply grabbed me here and threw me into the car, and then he dived in on top of me. And it was only then that I felt a paralyzing pain, and I learned that the bullet had hit me up here. When I walked in, they were just concluding a meeting in the hospital of all the doctors associated with the hospital. True, when I saw all those doctors around me too, I said, I hope they were all Republicans. I've been asked about a visitor that I had while I was recuperating back in March of 1981, Cardinal Cook. He was a wonderful man. a most dedicated man and just one of the most kindly men that I have ever met. And we were talking about some of the, call them coincidences, that had happened at the time of the shooting and that I had heard after I'd started to recover. And he said that in view of them, God must have been sitting on my shoulder. Well, he must have been. I told him that whatever time I've got left, it now belongs to someone else. A trip to Japan, Korea, and later to the People's Republic of China makes you realize that the old line, go west, young man, go west, still fits. There's a new frontier out there. There is a future. And the United States is going to be very much a part of that future. One cannot meet with those people without realizing that they are tremendously capable people, a talented and energetic people. And I found that there was a great longing for peace among those people. I think that we can have a fine relationship. We do already. But we can keep that and build on that relationship. Whether it's with trade, cultural exchange, we can be mutually beneficial to each other. We stand on a lonely, windswept point on the northern shore of France. But 40 years ago at this moment, the air was dense with smoke and the cries of men, and the air was filled with the crack of rifle fire and the roar of cannon. Here in Normandy, the rescue began. At dawn on the morning of the 6th of June, 1944. 62 of the Rangers who scaled the cliffs there at Pointe-aux-Hope, now back 40 years later to the scene of their heroic action. These are the boys of Pointe-aux-Hope. These are the men who took the cliffs. It was a very moving experience. They were what General Marshall called our secret weapon, the best damn kids in the world. Where do we find them? Where do we find such men? And the answer came almost as quickly as I'd asked the question. Where we've always found them in this country. On the farms, the shops, the stores and the offices. They just are the product of the freest society the world has ever known. Someday, Liz, I'll go back, said Private First Class Peter Robert Zanatta of the 37th Engineer Combat Battalion and first assault wave to hit Omaha Beach. Lisa Zanatta Hen began her story by quoting her father who promised that he would return to Normandy. She ended with a promise to her father, who died 8 years ago of cancer. I'm going there, Dad. And I'll see the beaches and the barricades and the monuments. I'll see the graves and I'll put flowers there just like you wanted to do. I'll feel all the things you made me feel through your stories and your eyes. I'll never forget what you went through, Dad, nor will I let anyone else forget. And Dad, I'll always be proud. Through the words of his loving daughter, who is here with us today, a D-Day veteran has shown us the meaning of this day far better than any president can. It is enough for us to say about Private Zanatta and all the men of honor and courage who fought beside him 4 decades ago, we will always remember. We will always be proud. We will always be prepared so we may be always free. I believe in the line I look to the hills from whence cometh my strength. Before I reached my decision to run for re-election, some people thought that maybe I'd be happy to retire to that beautiful ranch outside Santa Barbara and spend the rest of my life enjoying the simple things, riding horses, chopping wood, and spending time with Nancy, being outdoors and close to all of God's natural gifts. But they forget. There are so many things that remain to be done, so many challenges that must be met. I'd have felt like a quitter if I just walked away from getting federal spending under control once and for all, or from reforming and simplifying our tax system, creating enterprise zones, a set of incentives that would encourage business to help rebuild the troubled areas of our country, provide hope to those who yearn for true opportunity. And something else. Sitting in the Oval Office, you look around and sometimes you can't help but choke up a little bit because you're surrounded by history that somehow has touched everything in this room. And it occurs to you that every person who ever sat here yearned in the depths of his soul to bring people and nations together in peace. Four times in my life, America's been at war. That's a tragic waste of lives. That it makes you realize how desperately the world needs a lasting peace. Just across the hall here in the White House is the Roosevelt Room, named after the two Roosevelts who served here, one a Republican, one a Democrat. Many decisions are made in that room, and often as I meet with my staff, I gaze up at the five service flags, each representing one of the five military services, and draped from each flag are battle streamers, signifying every battle campaign fought since the Revolutionary War. Each ribbon a remembrance of a time when American men and women spilled their blood into the soil of distant lands. My fondest hope for this presidency is that the people of America give us the continued opportunity to pursue a peace so strong and so lasting that we'd never again have to add another streamer to those flags.
Today, 'cause there ain't no doubt.